We're familiar with electricity and its presence in our lives, but how does it come to be inside our homes? What systems enable electricity to exist there? Who makes these systems possible? The availability of electricity has not always been as ubiquitous as it is today. Over 100 years ago, Seattle City Light began constructing the Skagit River Hydroelectric Project in order to expand their electricity service to more people. Years before any road access to the Skagit Hydroelectric Project area, the public utility had to start by building a railroad system to access the beautiful but remote and often dangerous mountainous region. Company towns at New Halem and Diablo sprung up to accommodate the many workers and their families. Today, though much about operating a hydroelectric plant has changed, the remote valley still serves as a unique home and livelihood for many people.
My name's Nick Goddard. I'm a hydroelectric power plant operator on the Skagit project for Seattle City Light.
These folks work behind the scenes to keep the powerhouses in good shape and to keep electricity flowing down the 100 miles of transmission lines directly to Bothell, north of Seattle.
As a power plant operator, we ensure that the power plant and the associated dams and water rightways and equipment, and that they all operate in a safe and reliable manner.
Essentially, the Skagit Hydroelectric Project works like this. Dams create reservoirs of water. Then, operators release a measured amount of water through descending tunnels called penstocks to a large water wheel. The spinning of this water wheel, or a turbine, spins a generator composed of coiled and magnetized copper wires, which creates an electric current. This is transformed to a high voltage and travels through a switchyard, which directs the electricity onto the grid. Operators keep this whole system flowing smoothly. But in order to do this, they first need to get to the powerhouse, a task that is perhaps easier said than done. Gorge and Diablo powerhouses are located in the company towns, but the Ross powerhouse can only be accessed by boat on Diablo Lake.
It's pretty neat to, you drive up to the boathouse and you get on the jet boat and you get to go for that ride every morning and every day when you come back. It's really nice, actually. It's so neat that how similar that lake is to the inside waters of Southeast Alaska. It's just like being on a boat where I'm from.
Imagine making this trip every day. Imagine what it must be like to maintain and repair machines in a place like this. How would you do it? It turns out, all the machinery must be transported in the same way, by water. This barge is transporting a 50-ton piece of equipment called a transformer. They are essential for transporting electricity from such a rural location. This step-up transformer, as it's called, at the powerhouse converts the electric voltage to 230,000 volts in order to send it off. A paired step-down transformer at the substation in Bothell, in conjunction with other smaller transformers, distributes the electricity at a more reasonable 240 or 120 volts to your home. Without stepping up the voltage, much of the electric current would be lost along the 100 miles to Seattle, delivering far less power to the city. Needless to say, powerhouse operators and their co-workers have a lot of coordination to do.
Usually we come in and we have a coordination meeting with the other operators at the other powerhouses, because we all kind of work in concert together, maintaining water levels and power levels. We go about the day coordinating any work that might be done in the plant for maintenance or just operational changes. We work with machinists and constructors, which are our electricians. We call them constructors. And, if they need to work on a machine, we'll shut it down. We'll make sure that everything's safe and they can do their work.
If all of this coordination of electricity demand and water flow wasn't enough, Nick and his colleagues also contend with the unpredictability of working in a dynamic and changing landscape.
And then there's always, you know, the circumstances. We have a lot of emergency action plans in place for any kind of emergency for the dam. We have any problems with the operation of a generator or something like that, where, you know, we're supposed to be able to come in and assess the problem, make it safe to work on. There's always something happening.
Altogether, the Skagit Hydroelectric Project delivers about 20% of the city of Seattle's power. The next time you turn on an appliance or watch a Seahawks game, you'll know that power for 1 in 5 of those lights comes from the turquoise waters of the Skagit and the dedicated work of operators like Nick.
I think it's important for people to know that we take it really seriously up here. And part of what we as operators consider a safe and reliable operation of the plant is also taken into consideration the environment, and that we make sure that all of our machines are running as cleanly as possible to protect the Skagit River. It's what it provides a lot more than power for the people in the valley. So I think it's important that they know that we think about that a lot up here.
Thank you for watching this video about Powerhouse operation in the Skagit Hydroelectric Project, brought to you by North Cascades Institute and Seattle City Light.